Where's that revival going to have to start? Right within us, individually.
That's right.
It's got to start within us before it can spread to the whole world.
That's right.
I hear the sound of abundance of rain. God's pouring out His Spirit upon all men. Like the days of old, revival's here again. Smell the rain, and you can kindly look off in the distance, and you can hear it, and you can see it. Bob, I know you've seen it, and you think, I better get going. If I'm on horseback, I can remember being on horseback. See that rain and come. I can remember my dad saying, let's head for the house. Because it's going to catch us. We're going to have to see it by faith, folks. We're going to have to see it with more than just these natural eyes. Because we're not seeing it in the land today to a very big extent. But we're going to have to see it by the eyes of our faith. You know, God's working. We're this physical eye can't see it right now. But we're seeing, we're hearing testimonies of God's power working.
That's right.
We've got to believe it before we can actually see it in the natural.
Something else that happens, watch those leaves turn up on the trees to catch that rain. Linda taught me that. I didn't even. She said, "Watch those leaves turn up. It's getting ready to rain." I always tell her she's better than a meteorologist. She watches all that stuff.
I just feel a moving in my spirit. I did yesterday afternoon. Just a moving of the Spirit of God. That there's a great and mighty awakening about to hit this land. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Jesus, three robes of Sharon. Oh, there's peace that triumph when you speak His name. Oh, you say. Flowers in the snow. Jesus, sweet rose of Sharon.
I'm a very blessed person, and I'm just excited. God has done so much wonderful things in our life. All these kids have picked me to be their mama and brought me to a wonderful church and is happy to be here.
Thank you. Amen. All right.
If it wasn't for the Lord, where would we be?
Yeah.
I can't even imagine my life without Him.
God was in control of that whole situation.
And God was going to give that girl a answer and direction on what to do in her life with other people. And I just was so heavy-hearted, and I still am. If it wasn't for the Lord, where would we be? And she knows that, and it's... He's going to give her peace through it all. And He never will leave you. He never will forsake you. And that's what exactly I told her. I said, He's still there through all that. We can't see it. We can't see Him working, but He's working. So I know that it's all going to work out.
Encouraged and would share it with.
She just a favorite.
said, you know, that Bob sat back on the back, but then we might have some valves, that's the right word, put his lung. While he was over there, they decided he needed a pacemaker. So far, they kicked in. So far, they said it might take 2 or 3 weeks, but I felt this whole service. I want Brian and Carla to sing a song dedicated to you, Bob. It's, the song says, how's it, what's the first word?
It won't rain always.
It won't rain always. The sun's going to shine.
Shine in his own time, and he Yes, go ahead. Let's turn this one back on.
How's everybody doing today?
Good.
I woke up this morning, and every single Sunday, sometimes you might even notice some of the other, sometimes I'll come in a little later because you don't know what it took for me to get here. That's what was over myself this morning. And the Lord told me, he said, that's not only over you, Lord, that's over. I want you to raise your hand. If that rings true with you, that you don't know what it took for me to get here today. Just put your hand up. I mean, if you feel that way. And the Lord is also showing me, well, I do know what it took. The Lord showed me that as well. Because oftentimes it's getting up, trying to get your clothes on. It's hard to get in and do this and do that, you know, especially when you're over 29. That's what I'm talking about, okay? Or I'm talking about the fight you may have with your family member, your spouse, or your kid. You don't know what it took for me to get here. I work in therapy, so I work with older people. I know what they go through to get here, okay? But they're here. And the Lord said, what it took for you all to get here today and for me to get here today was accomplished on the cross 2,000 years ago.
Yes,
that's what it is. And God will give us the grace and the ability to do what he's put us on this earth for. Each one of us have a blueprint on our life. Your prayers and your tears will not go unnoticed, and you know that. This was just not a song service. This isn't just a... That's a pretty song to sing. We declare and we decree, because during this song service, that thing that was over me and was probably over a lot of people here came off of me. Because guess what? When two or three or more are gathered in his name, that he's in the midst of us, and there are power in numbers. This is a military right here. This is a military group in the spirit. And whatever isn't of God has to go, you know, when we get together and we meet. It's important. And the Lord also showed me that, I mean, raise your hand if you're over 70 in here. Well, no. I want you guys to know, okay, that part of the lie of the enemy that comes is that there's not much I can do. I'm old. I can't get out, and I can't do. You guys have one of the strongest messages residing on the inside of you because of the time that you were born in. These young kids, I want you to look around at these young children, these kids. They need your hope because you've lived through things.
Yes, amen.
You've lived through things. And they need to hear the hope, that there's hope out there, that it doesn't matter how dark it gets. Honey, I lived through a depression, and we made it through the depression. Honey, we didn't have nothing, but we had love. We had God, and God got us through it. Young people, I am here to tell you, this lady right here, and what she shared, it is so precious. She shared her heart that she was with her friend crying and praying out to God and crying out to God. He wants to do that in each and every single one of us. You know, we're all participants. We're all participants. And so I just want to encourage you, if you're over 70 today, I just pray, Lord, that you would release your spirit right now into this room. And that you would open the eyes and the ears and give us all new hearts today, Father, to endure this hour, to endure such a time as this, God. You've given us the power and the ability. And I thank you for it now. And I speak life over each person that's in this room today. Father, I ask that you would draw them unto you, that you would draw us, Lord, to your wing. And don't let us get too far, God. Keep us under your wing, and then, Father, work in and through us as you will, Father. And I thank you for each person here, Father. And, Lord, I ask that the people that are over 70, that they would begin to speak life and words of encouragement to this younger generation. I thank you for the intercessors that are in this room right now, Father. I thank you for their faithfulness, that their prayers and their tears have not been unnoticed. And Lord, we just speak faith and life into this day. And I thank you, Lord, for protecting each and every single one of us. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. Not by happenstance, you mentioned we're a military. We're militant against the things that come against our mind. That's what we're militant about. But it's not by happenstance you mentioned military. We have a military man here today. So, Duncan, would you introduce your recruiter?
This is Sergeant Jay Williams.
Hey, I'll turn my hand. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, Jay. In fact, if anybody wants to join us, we've got a 5K run after church.
Okay.
A little bit of push-ups,
a little bit of stretching. You're getting the weight off of Duncan. Okay. Linda?
Yeah.
You went to, who fell?
Brad.
Well, Brad fell. Okay. Terry, come stand by Linda. And I want you to stand by Linda. Their son not only fell, but Terry's niece was killed this morning in a bad car accident, head-on car accident. And the girl, I call her a little girl, how old is Tabby now?
She's probably 48, 47, something
like that. Yeah. Anyway, she's about the age of Sherry, I guess.
Carla.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, I think of her little girl. She's in our Christian school down in Salem when I passed her down there, and she was killed in a head-on wreck this morning. So I want at least one or two ladies to stand behind Linda and a couple guys to stand behind Terry today. And more than that happens, that's fine. Father, we just lift up Brad and we lift up the family of Tabby's family. Father, we just thank you that in this time, each one of them just reach out to you through their hurts, through their grief, and through their problems. Lord, may they just reach out to you. May you be their strength and their refuge at this time. And I thank you, Father, as Linda and Terry talks to Brad, and as Linda and Terry talks to Karen, Terry's sister, I thank you that their words will be anointed of the Holy Ghost to share strength and comfort in this special time. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. 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 Praise God. Thank you all for your support there. Thank you, Lord. Good to see Bill and Marie back. Amen. They've been quarantined in for a while. And just good to see everybody. Like I said last time, just good to see anybody nowadays. Amen. I want to continue a subject that I started a couple weeks ago on. God is never a loser. He's never a loser. It might look like it does. Jamie, I want you to put my whiteboard up if you would and sit right back behind me. We'll use it later on, but have it ready. God's never a loser. Maybe a subtitle would be The Lost Son. We call him the Prodigal Son. But all through these stories, Jesus is really teaching the kingdom of God. I forgot. Roberta, good to see you. This is Jamie's stepmom. Amen. Good to have Roberta here. And it's also, let me see, I've got to figure this out, Jennifer's husband's aunt, right? Okay. Anyway, I want to look at Luke chapter 15. If you got your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 15 and let's look at verse 1 and 2. It says, then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And verse 2 says, and the Pharisees and scribes murmured, so they were listening. So we've got four groups. We've got the publicans, that's the tax collectors, and the sinners. And you got the Pharisees and the scribes. The scribes is one who's scribed, I guess, who wrote the scriptures out and made sure it was all correct. So we've got two groups. We got a tax collectors who nobody liked. Well, he still don't like them. And We got the sinners, as far as the Jews concerned, they didn't like them either. But then you got the Pharisees, who are very pharisaical, who thought they did them wrong, and the scribes, they were perfect. So we got these two groups. Now, before we get through, we got two more stories in Luke chapter 16 that's all part of this parable. Jesus really talked to each one of these groups. But in the first verse, it says, "And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man received the sinners and eateth with them." So they must have been down to the sinner's house eating. Anyway, these three stories in Luke chapter 15 make up one parable. Now, we learned earlier that a parable is what? Could anybody stand and share what we said the definition of a parable was? We had it on the board here last week. Anybody here remember that? Anybody? Stand and tell that. It's what?
A fictitious story that conveys the truth.
A fictitious story of common life that conveys the truth. That's right. Let's all say it together. A fictitious story of common life conveying the truth. Say it one more time. It's a fictitious story of common life conveying the truth. So Jesus is using something that's common to what they would understand, but it conveys a truth. But it's a fictitious story, so he's not talking about anybody in particular. It's just something made up, something they could understand. If Bob was, I can talk to him and I could use a parable using trucks. He would understand that. Some other people may not have a clue, you know? You could stand up and tell me something about something I wouldn't have. You know, Foster back there, raise your hand, Foster, down there again. I can't imagine. He jumped out of a jet. He said he jumped out of a jet twice. I can't even fathom that. He said, well, you don't jump, you just go like that. But I can't fathom that. I can't even fathom jumping out of a slow airplane. Let alone a jet. Oh my gosh, it just... He could stand and use that parable. I wouldn't know what he'd even talk about. But anyway, parable is a fictitious story of common life conveying the truth. These stories are speaking to the publicans and sinners, Pharisees and scribes. All right? Now, to us today in 2020, we see something more, maybe a little more spiritual than they did in their day. But we see the ministry of the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and what else? The Holy Ghost, okay? We see in the story of the lost sheep, we see the ministry of Jesus Christ, the Son. In the story of the lost coin, we see the ministry of the Holy Spirit. But in this story today, we're going to learn about it's the ministry of the Father. And he operates different. It's all aspects of God. I said a few weeks ago that truth is like a diamond. It has many sides. The side of Jesus, he operates one way. It's all a ministry of God. The way the Holy Spirit works, it's a little different, but it's still a ministry of God the Father. And God works in his own way, too. It's all of God, all right? So, I want you to notice in each story, we find completeness, which is the ministry of the kingdom of God. And we'll start with Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 1. Ephesians 1, which I think you got up there, but we'll have it in a minute. Ephesians chapter 1. Look on your Bibles or your device or whatever you got. Ephesians chapter 1. Verse 2 says, "Grace be to you and peace." It's interesting. God always is a God of grace and peace, isn't he? "Grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings," where? In heavenly places. That's in Christ. That ain't in heaven or in glory land. I mean, y'all, that's just a given. You know it's going to be peaceful and graceful there, but he said, "Grace and peace from the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ." He's blessed us all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Those heavenly places is in Christ. if Christ lives and dwells in you, you're living in a place of in heavenly places. It's amazing how people can pray for somebody in California and it affects them. It's spirit. Spirit has no boundary. It's the same as when Jesus was walking the shores of Galilee and he touched the leper and they were cleansed. He touched the guy with the lame hand and it was straightened out. He left us the Holy Spirit to occupy, to live and dwell in us so that we can do the same thing. That's why we gathered around Terry and prayed today. So we believe that the families of his sister, who lost her daughter this morning in a car wreck, will be strengthened by the Holy Spirit, although they're not here to even hear what we're saying. We believe that, don't we? Yeah. We can pray for people afar off, or even in Europe or Asia, and the Spirit is just like lightning, goes there and ministers to them. That's the beauty of the Holy Spirit. That's what the kingdom of God is all about. So, he blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, that's in Christ, according as he had chosen us in him. When? So you were chosen before you ever knelt at an altar or ever prayed or ever asked Jesus to come in your heart. He'd already chosen you before the foundation of the world, according to this. And he chose us that we should be, number one, what? Holy. Number two, without blame. And number three, before him in love. Having predestinated or previously determined, God in his own way determined that when he made Adam and Eve. I'm not talking about predestination where you come back as an ant or a cow or something like that. I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about God previously in the mind of God, but when he created Adam and Eve, he knew Adam and Eve would fail. He created them with that ability, although he didn't want them to. That's where free will comes in. We believe in free will, but we believe also in limited free will, because we're going to see in this story, God is all powerful. He's omniscient. He's everywhere. He's he works in our messes. Let me say it that way. He works different than the way the Spirit works. He works different than the way Jesus works, but it's all part of him. All right. Having predestinated us to the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to what? The good pleasure of his will. He thought it good to do it that way. Now, there's people that it looks to me like they're pretty demonic to me. And I'd like to help him out sometimes and bless him with a brick. But that's not the Spirit of Christ. So I have to go back to something like this, and I have to just really believe it hard because I want to help God out. I see a lot of wickedness and I see a lot of devastation and I see a lot of stuff, but it looks to me like it's the devil to me. But then I have to go back and say, Jesus said after the resurrection, all power is given me in heaven and earth. Not a half of it, not a fourth of it, but all power is given me in heaven and earth. I have to believe that, although I see stuff that makes me want to doubt it. So to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the blood. You know how he made us accepted? It wasn't by our good works, but what he done on the cross, when he hung on Calvary's cross. That's how it was accomplished. Verse 7, in whom we have redemption. How do we have redemption? Through his blood. And through his blood we have what? The forgiveness of sins. And how can that be? According to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself. In my Bible, I took a little a pencil and I wrote, what is the mystery? I just asked questions, Lisa. I said, what is the mystery? Oh, it's in the next verse. He never leaves you without an answer. It says that in the dispensation, the fullness of times, you know, we've heard a lot of preaching over the years. You that went to church, we've heard about a lot of dispensations, but I've never heard any about the dispensation, the fullness of time. I've heard the dispensation of law, the dispensation of grace, and this and that and the other, but I've never heard one sermon on the dispensation, the fullness of time, but it's here. Here's the mystery. That in the dispensation, conversation, the fullness of time, he, what's the next word? Light. That leaves us a little bit of doubt. He might, maybe not, maybe will, maybe. You go back to the original text, you'll see that it was added by the translator. That he might gather together in what? In what? In one, all things have been added by the translators again. Trying to help it out. You know, when you got a little truth and you're trying to make it flow, you add words to it to make it fit. But it takes away from the truth. When it says things, I think of not only people, I think of other stuff. But you take the word things out, because it was added, you check me out, look on the Strong's Concordance, it's not in there, the original text. Let me start all over. That in the dispensation, fullness of times, he'll gather together in one, all in Christ, both which are in heaven, and which are on earth, even in him. Now let's go to Colossians. This gives us our jump start for today. Colossians chapter 1, about 10 verses there. Starting in verse 12, it says, giving thanks to the Father, which has made us meet. That's an old English term, a Shakespearean term, because the King James was translated about the same time as Shakespeare. Meet means partaker, able. Make us able to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in life. Verse 13, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. We think of translated when we go to heaven. That's okay too. We want to take away from that. But in our receiving Christ as our personal Savior, he's taken us out of that realm of darkness where we can't see and translated us into a kingdom of light where we can begin to get revelation and understand what he's talking about. It says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether it be thrones or dominions. Get the letter. Principalities are power. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things what? It says. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning of the firstborn from the dead, that in all things, there's things again. Now in this place it's italicized, but we know that's been added, that in all he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all, there's that word thing, unto himself, by him I say, whether they be in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies where? In your mind, by wicked works, yet now hath he what? You know the word reconcile means made mutual. If I come down to Golden and we're shaking hands and he'd say, Brother Mike, I really love you, and he said that lots of times, and I could say I love you too, or I could say the feeling is mutual. That's what reconcile means. The feeling is mutual. So the next verse says, in the body of his face through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. So we see here, God is all about reconciliation in the dispensation fullness of time. I want it today. I wish it had happened yesterday. But in the dispensation fullness of time, he's going to work it out because he will have it all. That's good news, my book. Amen. All right. What's in the lost sheep, we had how many sheep was it total? 100. He used 99, he used that as an illustration, and 1. Why didn't he use 87 and 3? I ask myself questions like this when I read the Bible. Why didn't he use 46 and 19? He was getting a point across of completeness. It was 100 sheep, but one went astray, and the shepherd went and found the one that went astray. We learned that in sheep, if the sheep gets on its back, it can't get up. And the sheep is one of the dumbest animals because it don't know how to get back. That's what my research said. I don't know what a sheep herder, but I happened to study that stuff, you know. I kept cows, and I did cattle judging in high school, and hogs, but we didn't have sheep in my country. So, but anyway, studying that up, they said a sheep can't find his way back. Now, I used to haul cattle with a semi for a few years, and I did see some load sheep at the stockyards in St. Louis, but the sheep won't go up the chute. They have a goat. And they put a goat in there, and the goat knows what to do. He just runs up the chute, goes up the trailer. Sheep all follow him. He works his way back out. They shut the door. They got the trailer loaded. And sometimes Christians are following goats. Sometimes Christians are really gullible. Anyway, it didn't cost you nothing for that. Anyway, present company accepted. You're not that way. Praise God. You follow the Holy Spirit. I love it. In the second story, the lost coin. There was 9 coins and 1 lost. Wonder why Jesus didn't say there was 6 and 4 lost. He's again teaching the Pharisees who thought they were super above everybody else. Jesus was showing that he included the tax collectors and the sinners. You know, one of the big tax collectors was a follower of Christ later on, became a disciple. So they changed their mind too. So Jesus' ministry worked, didn't it? Anyway, so we get today the story of the lost son. We see this family had 2 boys. One of them had to be older. The first one had to be older. And then he had the younger one. The younger one went astray and came back. So he had 1 + 1 = 2. So we got completeness. Now the family's complete again. We'll see that as we start. Now, the shepherd and the lost sheep went looking for the sheep. That goes along with what Jesus says. He said, "You've not chosen me, but I've chosen you." That's the ministry of Jesus Christ. The woman took a candle, and lit the candle trying to find this lost coin. You see, back in those days, they didn't give a wedding ring. The bridegroom gave a necklace of 10 coins, and she lost one. So she is adamant about finding this lost coin, so she got a light to sweep her house to find this coin and found it. She was so excited, she went and got her neighbors and her friends and said, "Come and celebrate, we found it," signifying completeness again. And the lost son, we're going to find out the ministry of God was different. He did not go look for the son. He created some things where he'd make a decision. So it was different. He did not go looking for the son. So that's the ministry of Father God. So we're going to start with Luke 15 and verse 11 today. Verse 11. Is that on the screen yet? We'll wait till Mom gets up there because I've got something I'll show you. What's the first word? And. Now, listen, I've told you this before. I just embody the chair in English. And Linda's my English person at home. And I'll say, "Linda, how do you know how to spell that?" She will, "E before I, before E," or however that goes, and accept Y, and then you do all of those things. I say, "How do you know that?" And I'll say, "How do you spell this?" She says, "You know, I run into that brain freeze on that." "How do you spell this facially?" And she's in the bed, and I was in the office, and she said, "ES." I done got that part. "PE," she spelled it up for me. Anyway, she's my English person. But anyway, she told me that "and" is a conjunction. Right? Help me out, sir. Somebody had just English. Would you just body in the chair too? And English. Oh, I hated English with passion. The Lord must have had a tongue in cheek and knew I'd be a preacher. And I don't know nothing about English, are they? But anyway, "and," the Rotherham translation says, "and he went on to say, a certain man had 2 sons. The younger of them said to his father, I don't know how many were here about a year or two ago when I taught on Father's Day about a father. A father is a source. Now, our society has changed that a lot. And we'll talk about that a little later on. I had a wedding just here yesterday. And, you know, when the groom was standing here and the bride comes marching in, her dad has been her source up until this time. Is that correct so far? But at a certain time in that wedding, I always say, who gives this woman to this man? And the dad says, I do. So he hands her off to the new man, who becomes the new source. Are you with me so far? Sort of like the new father. Now, they'll have children, so he'll be the father. So, he says, the younger of them said to his father, Father, or my source, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided them to his living. And he divided unto. Notice it didn't say him. It said them. So the older boy got his too. He may not took it right then, but it was divided to him. He knew what he was getting. See, in this day, I found this in my research, that if there's two boys in the family, one, the older boy got two-thirds. If they had more boys, the older one got half, and the other half was divided among the other boys. So they only had two in this story. So he got, the older boy got two-thirds, and he got the prodigal son, we call him, and that's all right to call him that. He got his part. It said, and not many days after the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a what? To a where? Far country. That's not in there. Jesus didn't just put that in there to have words. And there wasted his substance with riotous living. Well, he said, give me my portion. That's pretty selfish demand. And one translation says, I can't wait for you to hurry up and die so I can get my portion. So, kind of what he was saying to his dad. But he chose, it says he went into a far country. He leaves his homeland and goes exiled into a Gentile pagan country where he could live loosely without being censored by fellow Jews that knew him. So he went somewhere where no one would know him. That's a sphere of living where the father, the source, is not known. And he began to be dependent on that system. Now this might affect us today if we listen to this story closely. He began to be dependent on that system. And there he wasted his substance. He had lots of friends as long as he had money. He had lots of time for party until the money ran out. But the sweet fellowship of his father was exchanged for riotous living, a wasting of this precious inheritance. Riotous, I looked in the concordance and it gave the word dissolutely. I don't use that word. I hadn't heard any of you use it. So I had to look it up in the dictionary, see what it meant. And it meant immoral, having public disorder, and extravagant, immoral lifestyle. So he wasted it, all his substance with riotous living. And verse 14, and when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Now here we see, from this point on, we're going to see God at work. And I'll just say this for all of us today in 2020. A famine is sure to overtake anybody that wanders away from God. I didn't say God left them. We walk off from God, from our source. He found out by experience that this rebellious living left him in a dry place. And people who think they can get along without God, they're going to find themselves in a dry place. Things just don't work. Things might work for a little while, but it just won't stay working. Verse 15 says, and he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the field to feed swine. Of all things, this was a Jewish boy. They didn't eat pork, thank you. They didn't eat pork, let alone other feed swine. They might have had sheep and goats and cattle, but no hogs. He ends up in the hog pen, of all places. You know, when we wander away from God to kind of where we're at, emotionally sometimes, in the hog pit of despair, wondering how in the world, we use a term, a little cliche down in that country, how in the Sam Hill do we get down here? You know, I don't know what Sam Hill had to do with it, but I heard my grandpa and my uncle and them all use that term. But he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him to the fields to feed swine. Here, he has willingly spent his substance already. He has nothing left, right? Now he's compelled to give of himself. If we waste our gifts and privileges, we finally become slaves to something. Some people it's debt, some people it's drugs. Some people it's alcohol, some people, you know, whatever. But, you know, Angie, I just want to say a word to you, sweetheart. You're a prolific writer. And you can get down here and read my notes and tell it better than I can. Don't throw that away. Our word to all of us was good. But don't throw that away. Don't say I'm too old. Don't say I'm too busy. I got too many grandkids. They're running over me now. You can put a stop to some of that. But Dad's help. we never heard of what, I don't even know the term, ADHD or whatever. Is that the right term? Mom controlled that with all those kids and all my cousins that came over. She had a switch about that long. We had an old upright piano, and she just conveniently let it hang over there about 2 foot where you can see it. You'd be running through the house, you'd be like driving down there, you'd be driving 30 in a 40 mile zone and see a cop, you just slow up. You're not even speeding. We'd run through the house, it's that switch, we just slow down. We didn't want to be a recipient of that. So that controlled the ADHD at our house, you know. I'm not saying there is not that problem. I'm not saying that. But much of it could be controlled if it starts right here. You can't start at 12. You've got to start when they're little. I'm not saying you use a switch on them. But, you know, they might help. It might help be easy. Amen. So, let's spend what we got, or I'm talking to Angie. Don't lose what you got, Angie. You've got a lot of talent. Just say to yourself, I'm going to live a long life and I'm putting this in practice. I know you told me a while back you started writing again, so do that. Keep that up. And I want to see it. I want to read it and, you know, get it published. All that. Let's look at verse 16. And he would fain have filled his belly with husks. Fain means he had set his heart. I'm going to have to eat what the hogs eat. And no man gave to him. Wretched and self-willed. He no longer had anybody give him, so he's wanting to eat the same stuff they're feeding the hogs. You see, no person will ever be able to give you something if you're in that condition. Only God can. We can put our arm around them, we can love them, we can do all that stuff, but only God can feel that longing that you need. Verse 17, and when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough to spare and I perish with hunger? Here we see God at work. verse 18, and I will arise and go to my father. I'll go back to my source. And I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against him, against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me one of thy hired servants. He began to say, I'm going to go back to my source. You know what? A fire of hope began to spring up from the smoldering embers of his wasted life. I'm going to insert this right here, and this is way out of the box from my doctrine that I preached for years. When Jesus hung on the cross, stretched between heaven and earth, he shed his blood, he gave everything he had, his whole life. In one parable, Jesus said he looked, he found this field, he found a treasure. And he sold everything he had, said, you were the treasure. When I was a boy, they preached that he was the treasure. Well, I didn't sell everything I had to give him. He gave everything he had to give me. So he gave his whole life, he gave everything he had to buy back that field. And I believe in Matthew 13:38, it says, the field is the world. He bought back everything that Adam sold out. He bought it all back. So, I begin to see God working here in this story. Jesus is talking to publicans and sinners and Pharisees and scribes. And he's telling them how the kingdom of God really works. And we begin to find a gracious reception. Look at verse 20. And he arose and came to his source, came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and did what? Kissed him. We still see this. If you ever notice on TV, in the Middle East, even a guy, and I'm talking about somebody that's homosexual, I'm just talking about they'll kiss. That's a token. Now, Dave here, how many countries have you been in?
30 plus.
Oh my gosh. So he knows something about this. But in the Middle East, a kiss was a pledge of peace and reconciliation. So the father ran to him and kissed him in his rags and in his filth. I can see the son coming back. He's so distraught, saying, let me see. Father, forgive me. I've sinned against heaven. I've sinned against you. Would you just let me be with one of your hired servants? He may have been saying that over and over in his head so he wouldn't forget his speech when he got there. But the father runs to him and kisses him and grabs him, falls on his neck, hugs him, and gives him a kiss. The father kissed him before that prodigal son even uttered a word. So the father's kiss was, it took all the fear out. The father didn't postpone the kiss until he had made himself presentable. No telling how long his beard was by now. He didn't have to shave his beard. He didn't have to clean up. He didn't have to take a shower. He didn't have to do any of that. He didn't have to make himself presentable. He didn't ask forgiveness. The kiss was not the end either. It was only the beginning. Let's look at verse 21. And the son said to him, after the kiss, remember, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight. I am no more worthy to be thy son. And the father said to his servants, bring me a switch. I'm going to teach him a lesson. I kind of still believe in switches. But I don't believe in abuse. I'm totally against that. But the father said to his servants, bring forth what? Not just a robe, but bring the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hands and shoes on his feet. First of all, the robe signified royalty. Man, he wasn't looking for that. He just, if I could just stay out in the bunkhouse with the hired servant, I know I'm going to eat better than I did over there with the hogs. But he didn't stop with the best robe. He said, put a ring on his finger. Ring signified three things. It signified authority, it signified a name, and it signified access. Now, my research, I found out something else I didn't know. I have a lot of things I don't know, so I have to look them up. And I stumbled onto some things sometimes. Like, wow, this is from Abraham to Jesus. This is what happened in the Jewish families. When a baby is born, the dad presented that baby boy with a ring. And the ring had on it the coat of arms, the family coat of arms engraved on it. It was the family insignia, or signa, that was in mark. And as the boy grew, the baby grew, he didn't have to make another one, until it was an adult. But when he got big enough to buy stuff on his own at the merchant place, the boy on this ring, all he had to do was mash it down in wax, and put that insignia on there, and the merchant would charge that to the family. Kind of the first primitive credit card. I thought that's pretty interesting. Now, no slave ever wore a ring. Now, he also said put shoes on his feet. No slave ever entered the presence of their master. I learned with shoes. But the place to do a lot of digging. You find out a lot of stuff you don't know. No one gave, verse 23, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. No one ever gave to him when he was feeding hogs. But now all that the Father has, all that the source has, is at his disposal. By taking his portion earlier, or his inheritance earlier. Okay. Our 15 minutes is up. This concludes our Facebook message. So, you on Facebook want to go ahead and listen to the entire message, which is not very much longer. You can go to 2020-06-07. Thanks for that nod there. I did it right. All right. Continue. By taking his portion earlier, he had forfeited all of his rights to any future blessings. Now, in type, for us today, he's saved by grace. Right? And the Father's happy. Now, notice here, it says, bring the what? Fatted calf. Not just the fat calf, but the fatted calf. Now, I learned also in my research. Fatted calf here, the families always had a fatted calf. They had cattle, they had sheep, they had goats, they had other animals. Probably no hogs, but anyway, they had what they called the fatted calf. It was a calf that they took special care of, and they fed it special stuff, and they kept it for special occasions. If a dignitary or a celebrity came, they would kill that calf, and that would butcher, barbecue, or what we do today. But that they kept that fatted calf for that. And he said, bring the fatted calf, not just the fat calf out the pasture, but bring this fatted calf and kill it, and let's eat and be merry. For this my son was what? Yeah. For this my son was what?
Yeah.
Was he really? As far as the family is concerned, at one time he was, wasn't he? And is alive again. And he was lost and is what? Found. And they began to be merry. Wonderful. Dead. In our vernacular, or in our day, in our spiritual walk with God, is to leave the Father. Leave the source and go to some employment that we're trapped in. Sometimes we feel trapped. I've said over and over and over, some of you are retired now, you're not in that trap. But when you were in employment, that's not your source. If that job closed up for you, or younger, still working, if that job closed up, God is your source. You're not trapped, but some people feel trapped. We've trapped into a system that enslaves us. I want to put a word up here on the board, see if y'all recognize it. Anybody recognize that word? What is it? All right, I want you to listen to me. I want you to follow my directions. I want us all to say it real slow. Ready? Go. Mortgage. Say it again, real slow. Mortgage. What word did you hear in that?
More.
More. Isn't that strange? The root word of that is look in your dictionary, you'll find that's where I found it. The word morgue means dead. Gage? Does anybody know without looking in your... Some of you ahead of you always look in your device. Anybody know what that means just off the top of your head?
Direction.
Huh? Direction. The dictionary says it means... Alright. Trapped into a system which enslaves us. Our debt is called a mortgage most of the time. Mortgage. Dead. Pledge. Now, as we end this message today, let's look at verse 25. Now his elder brother was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard what? Music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, thy brother is come, and thy father has killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And the elder brother was what? Angry, and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. I've been in ministry now since 1972, so that's a lot of years. About 40-something. I've watched this often in churches. Christians are notorious for being jealous. So when we got to this location here, I started doing something a little different. And I did it with my family, but because I know what goes on. And if you don't tell me, I don't know. So you have to tell me when something happens in your family. If somebody gets a raise, I bring them up here. I say they got a raise. If they got a better car, I bring them up here. I want the congregation to learn to be happy for somebody else. If somebody got a new house, I want to be happy for somebody else that got a new house. I worked on a job for Walmart, and we didn't make really good money there. They're the highest pay in the trucking industry, actually. And if one guy got a new pickup, within 2 weeks, there'd be four or five more new pickups out there. But the other pickups were duallys or diesels or something a little better than the first one. Everybody had to beat the next guy. And I drove an old Ford pickup that Linda's dad had, and a cow had backed into the back of it and put a big old dent in it, and I just drove it over there. And so I didn't really have, we spent, at that time, we wasn't on a budget, we spent about everything we got. But they thought I was rich because I drove that old truck, because I wasn't in hock to $500 a month payment, and I'd park it right by theirs. And when I'd come in, they'd say, there's old Easy Money. I said, yes, sir. There's old Gravy. I said, yes, sir. I didn't have any more than they did, but I didn't let them know it. And I didn't feel intimidated. And I didn't have to have a new vehicle to park by theirs to get their paws. I just knew who I was, Lisa. I no longer to Jesus. And I liked the old truck. When I got it, it wouldn't even move. Linda's mom said, what are you going to do with that? She said, I won't move. I put it in reverse and I started to put it in reverse. It did start. And it sat there about 5 minutes, and finally it started moving. And I backed it out in the road, and so I put it in drive, and it wouldn't move, and I sat there and waited a little while, and finally it started moving. I got it to a station. I said, change the transmission fluid and put a new filter. I didn't know nothing about it. I thought, that'd probably help it. So they did that, and I drove it back to Kansas City. And I drove it for several years after that. But anyway, I didn't have to have a new pickup to make me feel better. Some people have to have something new to make them feel better, you know?
Jesus is my source. I'm not going to get trapped in that system.
I was working just like they were, but if that job would have told me, I wouldn't have had a nervous breakdown or would I, you know, God's my source. Amen. But this guy is really angry because somebody else, because of the son came back. And he said to him, my brothers, come, my father, and kill the fatted calf because he received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go in, therefore came out his father and entreated him. And he answering and said to him, lo, all these years do I serve thee, Father, neither transgress thy any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry my friends. But as soon as thy son was come, which he hath devoured thy living with harlots, wonder how he knew that. I think strange, don't I? thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said to him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. There's a scripture that goes with that. You have not, but you ask not. Amen. It was meet, it was necessary that we should make merry and be glad. For this thy servant was dead and is alive, and was lost and is found. Notice the family is complete at the end of the story. Understand, the message in the kingdom of God is completeness. For you that've got kids that you feel like haven't even given God any time, God's at work. In the lost sheep, Jesus went to find them. In the lost coin, the Holy Spirit was at work. But in the lost sheep, in the lost son, God just let them have their choice. I have a little saying that I tell people nowadays when they, well, why did this happen? Why did that? I said, oh, they ain't bumped enough. They ain't bumped up enough against enough brick walls yet. In other words, they haven't learned enough lessons yet. God's working. Sleep and rest. God's working. It ain't the end. It ain't the end. God's at work. When you think they're even thinking about it, they may be. Jobin and Angie. Harry and Linda. Who else can say them around here? Knows this guy, Bill Smith. He passed away today. A few months ago. But Bill, he said when he had a shop, automotive shop, and when he seen a Christian coming, and back then, I just say back then, we just thought smoking was the worst thing in the world, you know. Mm-hmm. If somebody comes off, we had to get them camels out of their pocket before we can pray for them, you know. We found out later you catch a fish before you clean it, you know. We had to clean them up first, we thought. But if he saw a Christian coming in, he'd run and grab a cigar. And he'd smoke it. And he'd just start cussing and just ranting and raving. He later got saved and told us that when he would do that, he said, I was fighting conviction the worst, the most. Let me say it that way. When I seen him come, he said, I was already convicted. But I tried to do and say things to make them mad, make them just leave my shop. Because he said, I was just that close from just giving my heart to the Lord. So just because your kids says stuff and hurtful, just remember, they're just skin close to saying yes to the Lord. God is at work. He's at work all the time. When you sleep, He's at work. When you're awake, He's at work. You know, the Bible says the kingdom is like a seed. When you plant it, it grows. Another time He says it's like leaven. When you put yeast in bread and you go off to town, it's working. You come by and sometimes Linda puts stuff, oh my God, that stuff is sticking up that dog. You know? It's working all the time when we're gone. That's the way the kingdom of God is. Take hope for your family members. Take hope and understand when it doesn't look like it's working, it's still working. And Jesus is telling these two groups of people, the kingdom is going to win. God is never, ever a loser. And in every story, in the lost sheep, he said there's more rejoicing in heaven over one that repented. And in the lost coin, he said there's more rejoicing than for the angels over one that repented. And here, he repented and came back. And the dad said, it's time to have a feast. It's time to make merry. It's time to have a good time. It's time to rejoice. So, I want us all to stand. And I just want us to join hands with whoever you're standing beside. And I don't know what your condition is. I don't know what your condition, your family is. But I just want you to know and understand that God is at work in your family members. He's working in your friends. Maybe you've had friends that just ditched you and went on their way. And you wonder what I did to cause that. God's still at work in all that mess. Father, I just thank you that right now, your spirit has never stopped working with our friends, with our family, and even with people we feel like are our enemies. You love them too, and you're working in their lives. We may not see it on TV last night or today, but it's still working. And I thank you, Father. Father, we have to realize, while we vote, while we think we want to vote for the best person, Lord, you're still bigger than all of that. We've got to be dependent on you, not a political party. We've got to be dependent on you. Father, we just thank you and we praise you that in all things, you have the preeminence with everybody. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
He'll do for you with arms wide open. He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do.
What God's going to do with Kevin and Mike and their wives.
It is no secret what God can do, what He's done for others, I know He'll do.
Thank you. Good news is going to show up in these families. Thank you, Father. Joel and Angie, I'm looking for even better news in your family. David and Merle, looking for good news in your family. I'm looking for good news in your family. Austin, Kathy, amen. Good news. Linda Buckner, I had about 2 weeks ago, I just driving down the road, wasn't thinking about Kendra at all. And the Lord just spoke up in me and said, I'll put people in her path. And just now, while I'm preaching, this thought came, I suddenly kind of get distracted because I'm hearing this thought back here and I'm trying to say something else. And the Lord says, she's going to remember some sermons preached by Brother Bateman. So, anyway, God's got this all under control. We want to fix it right now, wouldn't we? Sometimes they've got to go through some situations, you know. And people who make good money, sometimes they find out money don't produce what they need, what they really needed here. So God bless you. Y'all have a wonderful, wonderful week. And you know what, Lori, thanks for sharing. Other people, thanks for your testimonies today. We like body ministry here, so if you've got something to share, a word for somebody, share it. It's not all about me, it's not all about our musicians or singers, but we want you to participate. When you feel a word coming up, you share it, okay? God bless you. Have a great week. Shake hands with your family. God bless you.